it's difficult for me to do any better than what Mr. Long or Mr. Amstutz or Adams have already done before hearing from Senator Grendell as well. Just let me say that there comes a time, and far too often that time is ignored, when Ohio's leaders and politically elected officials need to stand up and recount it. And it wasn't an easy choice for me to decide to join in this lawsuit, but I did, because it's the right thing, I believe, for the people of Ohio. And it's the right thing to defend the interests of the people of Ohio that are not being defended by the governor, by the House majority, and by those who were unwilling to be vocal critics of a plan that, as Mr. Long already pointed out, was not appropriately vetted, was skirting, if not violating, the Constitution altogether in its implementation, and will be bad public policy, I believe, for the people of Ohio in the future. I think they have seen, had the foresight to see that, and to vote it down four times. I think it's incumbent upon those of us who agree with them to defend that position. And for me, this is, I fully understand, as a member of the Finance and Appropriations Committee of the House, and having sat through the majority of those hearings, I fully understand the difficulties that Ohio faces and the people of Ohio face, and I understand that many, I believe, they've not quite studied the issue well enough, but many believe that expansion to gambling would be an economic boom for the state government. I disagree with them, but I think that we have a responsibility as leaders to ask first the philosophical and social questions before we ask the revenue questions. And for me, and I think the majority of the people of Ohio have been proven time and again, we believe that the social costs of gambling are too high to count, and therefore we should close the policy. What frustrates me the most, and Mr. Amstutz did a fabulous job as our ranking member on the Finance and Appropriations Committee, and as a member of the Conference Committee between the Senate and the House, what frustrates me most is that we did not address many of the proposals that have been put forward by our caucus and even others to tackle some of the spending issues the state of Ohio has that would have offered responsible, legitimate alternatives to ignoring the will of the people of Ohio and forcing this down the people's throat without a vote, without appropriate deliberation. Namely, those bills are House Bill 25 and 65 and 66 and 210, and I believe 240. And I think that that is the reason that I am happy to stand here along with Representative Adams and Amstutz and the Christian Alliance. As Ron Amstutz said, in a complimentary fashion to the Business Roundtable, in our effort to defend what I believe is a wrong people of Ohio. This was a disastrous budget. I understand that it's a bad economy with bad revenues, but this was a disastrous budget that is going to be made worse by disastrous public policy that is not better than irresponsible. Thank you.
Thank you, for this action. Filed it about a half hour ago on behalf of the parties you see standing here. I want to commend the Ohio Christian Alliance for being willing to step up on the issue. And this is a profiles and courage moment for these three gentlemen to step forward and to be willing to stand behind the principles that are encompassed in this litigation. All of you who know me know that I believe that the Ohio Constitution is the supreme law of the state of Ohio. And that's because the Constitution comes from the people. And there's a right way to do things under the Ohio Constitution and a wrong way to do things under the Ohio Constitution. And when it comes to expanding gambling to include slot machines, the right way is to let the people vote on it. The wrong way is to use a governor's directive and then have the lottery commission enter into a joint enterprise with seven private racetrack owners, extending the credit of the state in aid of basically expanded gambling, mini casino slot parlors on private property. We have eight causes of action in the complaint. Some of them dovetail the round tables. One of which is particularly different is that we allege and we believe the law is clear that the state of Ohio can no more put its aid into a slot machine parlor with private racetrack owners and split the profits with them on a 50-50 basis than they could have gotten into the canal business or the railroad business after the Constitution of Ohio was changed in 1852. To prohibit those kind of private-public joint opportunities. But another way, as you'll see from some of the pleadings, The state of Ohio has no more right to lease some slot machines and stick them in a casino for Harrah's or Caesar's Palace than they do to lease those machines and get into a joint venture with the owners of the seven racetracks. The causes of action are against the governor, against the lottery commission, and against the director of the lottery commission. Copies of the documents have been served on all four earlier today. There are four documents, if you're looking at them for the media. One is the complaint petition, which is both for mandamus and prohibition, but also because HB 1 has a direct Supreme Court jurisdictional clause. We have brought all of our causes of action directly to the Supreme Court pursuant to the changes in 3770.21, the Ohio Revised Code and House Bill 1. There's also a motion to expedite the proceedings because we believe it's in the best interest of all Ohioans if the Supreme Court move forward with this. There's also a motion for a temporary restraining order or preliminary injunction supported by a very lengthy substantive affidavit signed by Representative Amstutz. And we do this because tomorrow is the date when these organizations are scheduled to give their first deposit on their permits, and we don't want any misunderstanding or argument of latches or contractual performance by the seven racetracks to foreclose the ability to bring this litigation. We are waiting for a call from the Supreme Court to see how they're going to handle the motion for the temporary restraining order. We hope that there might be a hearing today or in the next day or two. We think it's important that everything be frozen in place until the constitutionality of these actions have been decided by the Supreme Court, which is the ultimate arbiter on this decision. I will say this, the Supreme Court is a perfect place for this lawsuit because it is the job of the Ohio Supreme Court to make sure that the other branches of government and our balance of powers operate within the guidelines set forth in the Ohio Constitution. And so we're looking forward to the Ohio Supreme Court's favorable rulings on the causes of action as well. And I do commend the Christian Alliance, and particularly these representatives who have been willing to stand up for the people of Ohio on this issue. Thank you.
To make it less likely that you could prevail?
No, I think first of all, by filing, we've sort of locked ourselves in time here. The Supreme Court ultimately has all the powers that the Supreme Court has, which is all the powers the Supreme Court has. So if the Supreme Court decides, either way, if they decide to grant some sort of injunctive relief and stay everything, that would be a positive step. If they decide not to, it's not a negative step because the Supreme Court can still, and even will still, rule on the merits in our favor and would be able to require the state to get back any deposits that might have been paid while the litigation is pending. But what we want